Good morning. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation. My name is Clara, and along with John Tucker, Barb Powers, and we will serve you as your worship association team this morning. Our minister, the Reverend Eric Kamenetsky, will return to our pulpit next week on April 21st. For this morning, I am so pleased to present this worship, which has been coordinated by a group of the climate team and the Peace and Justice Committee, including myself, Barb Powers, Cindy Krieger, Gail Lieberg, and Steve Ernst. We have been working with our intern minister, Martha Durkee-Neuman, who we are delighted to welcome to the pulpit and share the message this morning. The climate team of the Peace and Justice Committee finds hope and support from each other as we face the enormity of the impacts of the global warming on our Earth, on creatures, on communities of people. Our journey together helps us learn and deepen our capacity to both feel the grief and to take action, which puts us in the interconnected web and protects the dignity of all beings. We work locally where our action has direct impact, for example, with high school students, limiting the logging of mature forests, helping people electrify their homes, divesting from fossil fuels. Will members of the climate team please give a wave? A few are out of town, so look for the bright green shirts to chat with any of us during coffee hour. We welcome you to join us on Zoom and the first Thursday evenings.
In preparation for our service, please put your phones in worship mode, which in this hall means pull out your phone, turn off the ringer. We welcome all of you to our service, especially those of you who are searching for a spiritual home. Many of us were once too, seeking something larger than ourselves to which we could belong, a sense of rootedness to hold us as we create meaning together. We do that well here, though not perfectly. In this congregation, we strive not for perfection, but for authenticity and connection. Whether it's your first time here with us in worship or your 100th time, we hope that you'll find here questions that stretch you, people to befriend you, and religiously liberal values to challenge you to join us in loving boldly, living justly, and welcoming radically. Now, if this is your first Sunday with us, we're guessing you want to know more about us and we want to know more about you. So you can help connect with things that you're hoping to find in this faith community. If that sounds good and you're on site this morning, please find someone at the welcome desk after the service and say hello. They're super friendly, and they can tell you all kinds of stuff about this congregation. Or, if that sounds good and you're watching us online, please go to our website at euc.org and click on the tab that says I'm New. When you do that, you'll find a drop-down menu link to our visitor form called What Are You Interested In? If you fill it out, we will send you more information about who we are and about who you can become if you choose to explore this amazing congregation. What happens after that is up to you. We invite, you choose. If you're here on site this morning and would like to gather to socialize after the service, please feel free to go out the double doors at the back of the hall, grab a hot beverage, and join us for coffee hour, either out there or back in this hall. Today is a multi-generational service. We welcome all children in our worship service, and we remind you that children are always welcome in all parts of our service, and the noises they make, any noises, there we go, are sacred and holy. We are happy you are here. And now we open the service with our land acknowledgement.
Let us remember that our congregational home, this site on which we are gathered this morning, is placed on the ancestral lands of the Snohomish people who have inhabited this region of the Salish Sea since time immemorial and who continue their livelihoods on these lands today. May we all live and learn humbly as allies to the Snohomish. Each week that we gather, we place a flame in the bowl of this chalice, thus completing a ritual of our faith tradition, Unitarian Universalism. We ignite the flame at the opening of our time together, making real a symbol of the light and the love and the warmth we bring when we gather. And we reclaim the flame, that light, that love, and that warmth as we close, so that we can take them with us and bring them out to a hurting world that could not possibly need them more. This morning we light our chalice and we light a special green candle as this service is in celebration in honor of Earth Day. We light this chalice and candle with words from Climate Team member Gail Lieberg. As we kindle this flame, we bring our attention to the more than human world, the more than human world of which we are a member. We acknowledge the gifts of the natural world and our reciprocal relationship with one another. In a spirit of gratitude, let us kindle in ourselves the responsibility to care for and protect all in the interconnected web of which we are but a part.
Let us now say our affirmation. You can say it out loud, read along, listen to the group reading, or otherwise participate as you wish. We need each other, so we come to this place to work and dance and laugh and cry and think. We call ourselves a religious community. Not because this place in and of itself holy ground, but because what we do here and say here and are here make it so. So let it be. We now welcome forward our choir, as directed by Matt Smith, to perform I Dreamed of Rain by Jan Garrett, arranged by Larry Nickel.
wonderful work, choir. Wow. May we all dream of rain and peace. May it come. Thank you. Thank you, Matt. Good morning, friends.
Good morning.
Oh, thank you. You give me energy. You know that. Today, we are coming together as a people of all generations, across our ages and our life stages, to think a little bit about our relationship with our beautiful planet that we get to live on. As UUs, we use a lot of different spiritual texts to help support us as we live our lives. Today, we're using a sacred text that is called Braiding Sweetgrass. It's a book by our friend Robin Wall Kimmerer. In our church, we don't believe that any book is more or less sacred or inspired than any other, and we invite you to bring to us the many different places in your life where spiritual wisdom can come from. So Robin Wall Kimmerer is a botanist. A botanist is somebody who learns from and then teaches us about plants. She is an indigenous Native American person, an enrolled citizen of the Potawatomi Nation. In her book, she talks a little bit about the process of braiding a plant that is called sweetgrass. So today, we're going to talk a little bit about braiding and then have a chance to do a little braiding together. So in a moment, I'm going to need 4 volunteers who already know how to braid. So be thinking, kids will get first dibs, but if I can't find braiders, then grown-ups, you're going to get picked. Think about if this is a you in just a moment. All right, so what is sweetgrass? This is braided sweetgrass. Sweetgrass is a plant that grows wild and native in the North American wetlands, particularly in the Atlantic and Gulf coasts, in wet meadows, low prairies, bogs, and marshes. The scientific name is Hyrochloe odorata, which means a fragrant and holy grass. In Robin Wall Kimmerer's language, it is called wishagaskik, which means the sweet-smelling hair of Mother Earth. When growing, it smells a little bit like vanilla. Indigenous people have used sweetgrass for many different purposes. Different tribes have different uses. The Blackfoot people have used it as a perfume and brewed a tea from it to treat infections. The Chippewa people have burned it in ceremonies and used it as a purifying smudge. The Algonquian people have woven it into coiled baskets. The Gullah community of South Carolina, who are descendants of formerly enslaved people, have also passed down a sweetgrass basket weaving tradition in their community. I will read you some words from our friend Robin about how it is braided. A sheaf of sweetgrass, bound at the end and divided into thirds, is ready to braid. In braiding sweetgrass, so that it is smooth and glossy and worthy of the gift, a certain amount of tension is needed. Any girl with tight braids will tell you that you have to pull a little bit. Of course, you can do it yourself by tying one end to a chair or by holding it in your teeth and braiding backwards away from yourself. But the sweetest way is to have someone else hold the end and pull gently against each other, all the while leaning in, head to head, chatting and laughing, watching each other's hands, holding steady while the other shifts the slim bundles over and over, each in its turn. Linked by sweetgrass, there is reciprocity between you. Linked by sweetgrass, the holder is as vital as the braider. Okay, so we're gonna give it a try. I don't have any sweetgrass big enough for this activity, and it's not its season. But this may look like a bed sheet, but it isn't. You'll just have to come along with me. This is our sweetgrass representation. Okay, volunteers. So I need 4 volunteers who are braiders. I see 1, 2, 3, 4. All right. Come on up, 4 volunteers.
What
work. Here we go, our braided sweetgrass. Very good braiders, very good audience, good encouragement and advice and support. All right, so we noticed that that took a lot of different things, right? We needed some tension from both sides. We needed some directions giving in the middle. We needed some audience encouragement and sometimes advice and wisdom. We need one another. We need each other to do the tasks that are in front of us that we cannot do alone. And when we use one another's skills and resources, we can make something different and beautiful than what we had before. We need to build some reciprocity with one another. Reciprocity is a word that means giving and receiving in a way that binds us together. How we lean on one another matters. How we lean on one another in strength, in tension, with our different skills, matters. You hold this thread while I braid. We can do it together. And something that I have learned from Robin Wall Kimmerer is we will need different threads to put this braid together. This braid is beautiful because there are lumps and bumps in the process. We learned a little bit while we did it. We learned about our different heights and what might be needed to come together with our different heights to make one braid together. And it is beautiful because these threads represent different types of knowledge. For the task that is in front of us, we will need scientific data. We will need wisdom from the world's traditions. We will need the things that you know about the planet. We will need the wind, the way that the wind feels in your hair, and we will need the things that you have experienced. We will need hope and some animals and the Salish Sea and blackberries and a salamander and some good books. And we will need each other and our commitment and our love. This is what we owe one another and our earth. Bringing our gifts together, being willing to lean on one another to make it so. Thank you.
And now we'll share a moment of peace. This morning's words have been adapted from the Unitarian Universalist Ministry for the Earth. We invite you to sit and settle your mind and body in any way that feels supportive. You might close your eyes or lower your gaze. Notice your breath, how it comes in and how it goes naturally. Feel yourself settle even more deeply, and then pose this question to your heart. What in my natural environment do I love? Simply ask and notice whatever arises. Make space for anything and everything. Deepen this inquiry by asking, how would losing this cause harm to me or others? Keep listening and honoring whatever arises. As something clear emerges, appreciate your connection, your commitment, and your devotion. And now in your imagination, offer a gesture or a phrase to express your love. Gently come back to this present moment. You might want to wiggle your toes or your fingers. Open your eyes as they may have been closed. May it be so.
Today's service is in honor of Earth Day and is focused on our commitments to and with the planet. We want to pause in this moment to offer a special prayer. We acknowledge that to do the work of loving and fighting for and protecting our planet is hard work. And since much has already been destroyed and lost, part of moving forward together is acknowledging the grief that many of us are carrying. We offer this prayer in the spirit of remembrance and care. Spirits of earth, waters, and air, be with us in this moment and all moments. For all our natural spaces which have been harmed due to climate catastrophe, violent extraction, and practices driven by greed, we hold deep grief and reach out in tender care. For all our beings, humans, plants, animals, and ecosystems who have been lost due to these practices, we remember and honor your lives and existence as holy and worthy. We pray for forgiveness for all that could not, for all that could have been saved and was not. We pray that all which remains may be protected and restored. We acknowledge the expressions of lament, regret, and grief that live in our hearts, and we offer them to you, spirits, that they may be held and healed. Amen, and may it be so.
Thank you, John. Okay, grown-ups. Today is April 14th, which means tomorrow is April 15th. I hear you already nervous. Is there anything special that happens tomorrow?
Coral's birthday.
Happy birthday. Tax day. All right, so not everybody's favorite holiday. Some of us might still be waiting to do their taxes. No, we don't. Don't raise your hands. We don't do shaming in our church. When I was just a little bit younger than I am now, tomorrow was the day on which I would do my taxes. Now I'm a little bit older and a little bit wiser, and I try to do them before April 15th. But I do my taxes because I live here and I am a citizen of this country. And doing my taxes is one of the obligations that is a part of belonging here. I attended public schools, I drive on public roads, I walk almost every day in the park near my home, which is nice and clean. My trash is picked up every Thursday. I did not choose to be born here, but I was, and thus I have entered into a mutually agreed upon, sort of, relationship between a citizen and a nation about what it means to belong here and what we owe one another when we do. Some of us were born here and some choose to come here, some were brought here, and we may not agree with all the contractual obligations that are placed upon us. I definitely do not agree with all the decisions that my government has made about what they do with my money, but still I pay my taxes. Not just because it is the law, but because I have a shared understanding with my country about what it means to belong. I fulfill my obligations. I also sometimes protest my government, because to me, that is what is part of being a good citizen. It means caretaking my neighbors and advocating for what I think is right. You only fight for something if you really truly love it. So this, too, is good citizenship. I also did not choose to be born on this particular beautiful earth. but I feel really deeply honored and lucky that I was, and that you were, too. And thus, there are certain things that I do for the natural world of which I am a part. And I have been learning about everything that it does for me, too. Robin Wall Kimmerer talks about a silent nation that sometimes goes unnoticed in her community. A nation of maple trees. In her town, there are more maples than there are people. And in so many ways, seen and unseen, maple trees meaningfully contribute to the community. Robin says that being a good citizen is sharing in the support of your community. The shade of the maple trees brings down everybody's energy bill and keeps animals and people cool in the summer. They provide syrup for yummy treats, and so that the fire department can have an annual pancake breakfast, raise money for a new fire engine. They block the snow from falling on the roads in the winters, which means the plowers don't have too much plowing to do. The maples, as with all of our trees, contribute to the air we breathe, putting oxygen into our atmosphere and capturing and storing carbon. They provide homes for wildlife so that squirrels don't have to live in our homes. And when the leaves fall to the earth, they create mulch and the soil is enriched, allowing us to farm and plant crops. And when it comes to making our communities beautiful, there is no parallel to when the leaves change color. Robin calls this the Civic Beautification Maple Committee. Ecological scientists call this phenomenon ecosystem services, the structures and functions of the natural world that make our lives possible. Precious and unnoticed, unaccounted for in our economic system. We don't have to hire extra plow people because of the maples, but we don't notice that we don't. So the maples fulfill their responsibilities, their obligations to being a good citizen of Maple Nation. They do so patiently, without complaint, with love and care, incredibly reliably, even without an IRS notification. And yet we, who constitute some of the beings who benefit the most from these gifts, don't pay them our taxes. We don't always honor our similar responsibility to the maples, even though they dutifully honor their responsibility to us. Maybe we lack a shared understanding of what it means to belong to one another in this way. Robin asked some of the members of her community about what it might mean to be a good citizen of a nation of maples. One of her friends said simply, "You take care of the trees and they take care of you." Another says, "You take what you are given and you treat it right." This is the responsibility that I owe. When I look around at my life, through a lens of responsibility, I begin to see just how many reciprocal relationships I am in, chosen and unchosen. Relationships of contractual obligation, perhaps. I pay my taxes begrudgingly. But also relationships grounded in mutual responsibility. I love the people that I have promised my life to. I love all people. I see what I have been given, and I see my responsibility for care, to care for all that which cares for me. The arms of those trees are always holding me, but it's easy for me to forget. It's easy for me to not notice my breath in and out, as aided by my giants, these neighbors. Sometimes I take them for granted, and I forget about upholding my side of the bargain. Okay, grown-ups, what are the first 10 amendments to the US Constitution called? The Bill of Rights. You didn't think that church was gonna come with a government pop quiz today. We like to keep you on your toes here at EUUC. So the Bill of Rights teaches us that because we live here, there are certain things that we are owed. For many people in the West, the language of having certain rights that we are owed has helped people gain access to justice and safety, to advocate for better care and legal protections. Having rights is an important part of protecting one another and what we are owed in a nation like this one. But one thing that I have learned from Robin Wall Kimmerer, when we think about the difference in citizenship when you live in a nation of maples, is what I owe if I think about a bill of responsibilities instead. I am of this world. I am of this world, of this earth. I belong here, and so do you. We are of and a part of nature. We are citizens of this particular planet, and our earth is incomplete without us. And because that is true, I have certain responsibilities to and with this great green earth. Robin writes, "If citizenship is a matter of shared beliefs, then I believe in the democracy of species. If citizenship means an oath of loyalty to a leader, then I choose the leader of the trees. If good citizens agree to uphold the laws of the nation, then I choose natural law, the law of reciprocity, of regeneration, of mutual flourishing." Sometimes when I stand among the nation of trees with my head looking up, I feel overcome with my own gratitude. How remarkable, how utterly and unbelievably cool that there are giant trees on this planet here with me that take carbon out of the atmosphere and produce oxygen for me to breathe. How could I ever repay that sense of gratitude that I feel deep into my bones? But Robin helps to show me that in a bill of responsibilities that me and the maple trees share, my gratitude, my unending love that I feel for these giants is one important part of how I give back to them, but it is not the end. This gratitude, this sense of my own belonging, comes with certain obligations. I love these trees. I love this planet with my whole heart. I feel my gratitude, and what does that love ask of me? What does that love require of me to do? Cornel West taught me that justice is what love looks like in public. So I will take my love and my gratitude, and I will let it change how I live. I will do what I can do in my small part of the world to make my planet a more livable place for us all. Not just on an individual scale, but together, in a community, in a nation, in a society, in a world, in a collective scale. This might mean divesting money from fossil fuel companies and making green choices in my home or my church. It might mean joining with my neighbors all over the world in holding fossil fuel companies accountable and governments accountable for climate policy. It might mean coming together in movements for climate justice and resilience and taking action together. It might mean getting creative when building new institutions and frameworks for a just and sustainable future for us all, us and every maple tree and every being. This is a key part of my bill of responsibilities to and with the trees. Robin says, "Individuals far wiser than me have said we get the government we deserve." This might be true, but the maples, our most generous of benefactors, our most responsible of citizens, do not deserve our government. They deserve you and me speaking up on their behalf. Political action, civic engagement, these are powerful acts of reciprocity with the land. The Maple Nation Bill of Responsibilities asks us to stand with the standing people and to lead with the wisdom of the maples. The resilience of these trees shows us the way. Even when it feels hard and it feels hopeless, all is not lost, because each day the maples give me shade, and they give me oxygen, and they give me sweet, sticky syrup. What a gift. And each day they fulfill their side of a promise I didn't know I was in. They uphold their side of a bill of responsibilities, and all I can do is honor mine. So when the way forward seems unclear or difficult, let us learn from our gentle giant neighbors who keep on providing for their community anyways, and let us do the same. I want the maple trees to expect the best from me, and I will do my best to rise to the occasion. So my friends, what will your commitment be? Blessed be. And amen. So we are going to do a little practice together. I'm going to invite you in silence for a moment to reflect about a commitment or an intention that you want to make today. A commitment to and with and for your planet. A commitment with maples, a commitment for Earth. It can be as small as a practice of gratitude that you want to center in your life, as big as a change you want to make, as big as a movement that you want us to be a part of. It is yours, and it is up to you. In an Oprah style, if you'll look under your chairs, you will find a maple sticky note and maybe a pen. I invite you to grab that maple sticky note, and there's not quite enough pens for everybody, so please share with your neighbor. I'm going to give you a moment to reflect, and when you've come up with your commitment, please write it on your sticky note. If you don't have one, give me a wave, and I'll come around during the silent time and I'll bring you one. So please write your commitment on this sticky note and then hold on to it. When our service concludes, there's a maple tree that I made in the narthex, and we're going to have a chance to stick our commitments onto the maple tree together. We will collect those sticky notes for a visual, artistic representation of the commitments of this community. For our online friends who are watching on YouTube or on Boxcast, if you would like, you may write your commitment in the comments, and after the service, a member of our team will transfer the online commitments onto sticky notes onto the tree. If you would like your commitment added but a little less public, email it to me at martha@euuc.org. Okay, I'll give you a few moments of silence to do this. Ready? What is your commitment? And wave at me if you need a sticky note. hold your sticky note in your hands. We are going to bless these commitments together. I will invite forward Matt, who's going to teach us a little sung blessing for these commitments.
All right. Hello. Testing. I can hear. Okay, good. I'm going to teach a short little song that we're all going to sing together. And give me a B flat. So I'm going to sing one verse of it, and then you guys repeat it with me. And then I'll sing it second verse, and then you'll sing that. What does the world require of us? What does the world require of us? Go ahead. Here we go. And what does the world require of us? What does the world require of us? Justice, kindness, walk humbly on the earth. Justice, kindness, walk humbly on the earth. Let's put it all together and sing together. Here we go, with me and with music behind us. Here we go, one, sing. What does the world require of us? What does the world require of us? Justice, kindness, walk humbly on the again. What does the world require of us? What does the world require of us? Justice, kindness, walk humbly on the earth. This side, here we go, ready, and what does the world require of us? What does the world, keep going, choir of this side. What doth the world require of us? What does the world require? Continue. What does the world require of us? What does the world require? Continue and what does the world require of us? What does the world require? And off. Justice, kindness, walk humbly on the earth. Thank you, everyone.
May that bless our commitments. After the service, be sure to stick it on the tree in the narthex. We recognize that we are all interconnected with one another and with our planet. When you drop a pebble into water, its ripples go out and touch everything. Every action that we take impacts our whole. We will now enter a time of our reflections ritual, holding this knowledge as central. During this time, we invite you to come forward and drop a pebble into this water. If you would like to honor a special commitment or a wish, let go of a little bit of pain or fear, or share a hope for yourself or the planet. Forgive yourself or another, or mark an event, an occasion in your life. We invite you forward, as is being demonstrated, to send forward your thoughts into the ripples of this water, awesome work, into this community. This is a ritual that we do in our community together each week, knowing that we all show up here carrying different joys, fears, sorrows, and hopes of our lives. We invite you to bring whatever you are carrying to this bowl, knowing that it can be held here in this community. As the beautiful music plays, please feel free to come forward. We invite you to approach by the outer aisles and depart by the center. I will begin by dropping one pebble for all those who wish they were with us, and another for everyone who we wish was here.
Thank you.
May it be so. We will now welcome forward our choir, as directed by the incomparable Matt Smith, to perform you I Plant You a Garden by Greg Gilpin. Thank you.
If you are new to our gathering, it is important for you to know that EUUC's weekly offering does not support the ongoing operations of this congregation. We support our congregation by making generous pledges of financial support that we pay month by month, year by year. Our Sunday offering is dedicated to going right out into the world to support organizations doing good works that align with and extend the mission of this congregation. Gathering together, nurturing the spirit, living our vision of a just and sustainable world. April Calls of the Month is Kicking Gas. Kicking Gas is a local campaign led by the nonprofit For the People, with collaboration from Readiness to Learn, City of Langley Climate Crisis Action Committee, Salish Sea Cooperative Finance, Snow Isle Sierra Club, and Island Ductless Heat Pumps. It is a grassroots Whidbey Island-based climate justice organization working to help electrify homes and improve the health of our communities by increasing affordability and awareness of the health and environmental impacts of fossil fuel combustion and usage. The Kicking Gas program empowers people with low to moderate incomes to electrify their homes by providing education, funding, and to trusted contractors, referrals, and financing if necessary. Their mission is to, one, fight the climate crisis by keeping fossil fuels in the ground, two, promote improved indoor and outdoor health by reducing greenhouse gas emissions, three, improve safety in their homes and neighborhoods due to the reduction of gas lines. Four, improve energy efficiency and lower household energy costs. In 2024-25, they are aiming to convert 150 homes from propane, oil, wood, or so-called natural gas to electric for cleaner indoor air, bodies, and communities. They operate on Whidbey Island, Snohomish County, and Bainbridge Island. Funds will be used to provide more electrification equipment and installs, which will increase the number of home electrifications Kicking Gas can facilitate. This organization was nominated by the Peace and Justice Climate Team. As always, thank you for your generous contributions. If you have an organization that you wish to nominate for the Sunday Cause of the Month, we invite you to fill out the online Sunday Cause nomination form. If you are online or if you are on site and have your phone in your hand, you can find and donate to the Sunday Offering Cause of the Month on the EUUC website on the Give to EUUC page found under the Giving tab. Or if you're on site and you have cash or a check with you, there are baskets out in the narthex where you can contribute. Just go through the doors, turn around, and you'll see one underneath the screen on the wall, and the other is over by the coffee. Please be generous within the limits of your budget. We invite you to rise in body or spirit as you are comfortable to join in singing. We invite you to hold the commitments you have made earlier in the service in your mind as you sing this hymn together.
From the light of days remembered burns a beacon bright and clear, guiding hands and hearts and spirits into faith set free from fear. When the fire of commitment sets our mind and souls ablaze, when our hunger and our passion meet to call us on our way, when we live with deep assurance that the flame burns bright within, then our promise finds fulfillment and our future can begin. memories of our living, rings of young, both brave and free, calling pilgrims still to witness to the life of liberty. When the fire of commitment sets our mind and soul ablaze, when our hunger and our passion to call us on our way, when we live with deep assurance of the flame that burns within, then our promise finds fulfillment and our future can begin. From the dreams of youthful vision finds a new prophetic voice, which demands a deeper justice built by our courageous choice. When the fire of commitment sets our mind and souls ablaze, when our hunger and our passion meet to call us on our way, when we live with deep assurance of the flame that burns within, then our promise finds fulfillment and our future can begin.
We have several announcements today. Board and Finance Committee notice. You will have two opportunities to review the proposed annual budget with members of your Board of Trustees and Finance team. You will also be able to view both the operating budget and the social justice budget and ask questions at this time. We will be available on Sunday, April 21st at 7 p.m. on Zoom and in person, and again on Wednesday, April 24th at 7 p.m. only on Zoom. EUC auction, your donations welcome. It's time to buy your tickets for our live auction on April 28th, a fun lunch event where you can bid on a Costa Rican or Hawaiian getaway, a place at a four-course Australian dinner, or a slot in a progressive dinner around the world in 10 miles with transportation provided. Buy your tickets at the auction table in the Narthex after the service or on our auction website. We really need your help at the auction, so please sign up to volunteer. Can't make it to the auction? Everyone can participate in our online auction, which begins April 24th. See this week at EUUC or euuc.org for more details. 2024 Wind Diversity, Equity and Inclusion Workshop. Join Washington Indivisible Network and Indivisible Leaders, members across Washington and Oregon, Saturday, April 20th, from 10:30 a.m. to 12 p.m. for a series on virtual diversity, equity, and inclusion workshops led by DEI consultants Lillian Hawkins and Latricia Kinlow. In order to save our democracy, we must continually improve our dedication and ability to organize with an anti-racism lens. Whether you are new to these ideas or returning to them, we hope you will join us. Register for the event by going to the link provided in This Week at EUUC. Being and Raising Anti-Racists, a discussion and exploration for parents, family, educators, and caregivers. Saturdays, April 20th and May 4th, from 10 to 11:15 a.m. Attend in person at EUUC or on Zoom. Contact Racial Justice at EUUC to register. Note the ages of children with you, child care provided. All ages, nature, immersion, and creative gratitude. Please join the climate team and the Racial Justice Committee in an Earth Day All Ages Nature Immersion. April 21st, after the service, we will gather together to deepen our connection to nature and creatively express our gratitude. Child care for the littlest and special activities geared to all ages. There will be snacks. Register at the Social Justice Desk or through the link at This Week at EUUC. All are welcome. Women's Centered Circle, join us at noon today in RE 1 and 2 for the next meeting of the Women's Circle at EUUC. Bring your bag lunch and join us for after worship. We will gather to connect, reflect on spiritual practices together, get to know one another, and be in community. This space is welcome to all women and binary folks who feel that it is the right space for them, and led by Intern Minister Martha Durkee-Neuman. Writing postcards to Georgia and Virginia primary voters. Come to join Democracy Action Team in writing postcards to BIPOC voters who don't regularly vote. The Center for Common Ground's Reclaim Our Vote campaign hopes to boost BIPOC turnout in congressional primaries in key states, Virginia and Georgia. All materials will be provided. No sign up is necessary. Come to the Friar Place today and on the 28th at 11:15, ready to write. Emma's Revolution, tickets on sale in the Narthex. This is our Raise Our Voice, Get Out the Vote concert. Tickets are available today during coffee hour and online, tinyurl.com. APR 20 EUUC. For more information or to volunteer, please check with Carolyn or Cynthia or email us at concert@euuc.org. Please share this announcement and let's pack the house.
First, I will share a benediction from Diana Smith to extinguish our green candle, and then we'll release our chalice flame together. Thank you. As we go forth in this space, may we celebrate Earth in our shared lives. May we recognize our connections to all that is and on Earth. May we truly and deeply value the inherent worth of all. In this awareness, interconnection, web of existence. May we commit ourselves to a new way, and may we hold our commitments to each other, gently yet firmly. Blessed be. Amen.
If you will join me with the words printed on your screen as we release the flame of our burning chalice. We release this flame, but not the light of truth. We release this flame, but not the warmth of this community. And we release this flame, but not the fire of our commitment. These we will carry in our hearts until we meet. Resilience. The lessons are everywhere. Our service has concluded. After our service, several volunteers from this community will be taking this water, which we have placed our intentions into as a community, outside to water some of the plants of the green space of our sanctuary. We invite anyone, particularly young folks, if you want to help with that, to come up here to help with that project. We will hear some walking out music from Paula. You are welcome to hang out here, go out and have a beverage, come back in here, check out the playground, hang out with our kids. And finally, we give thanks to all of you who make this service and this congregation possible. Go in peace. Be sure to put your commitment leaf on the tree in the narthex. Thank you, climate team members. Now you may go in peace.